What's up, YouTube? Today, I'm gonna show you how to install an OME 2-inch heavy-duty lift kit and JBA upper A-arms for your 2005 to 2010 Jeep Grand Cherokee WK. Here's all the parts we'll be using today. We have the front shocks, rear shock, and front and rear springs. We also have the JBA upper A-arms, some extra nuts and bolts for this lift. There are some nuts and bolts on the actual Jeep that are lock nuts and lock bolts. So what you don't want to do is reuse the old hardware. Now I'll go ahead and list the part numbers that you need for those lock nuts and lock bolts in the description for this video. A special thanks goes out to 4xguard.com. Marlon and his crew are super awesome to deal with and supplied all the parts that you see here in this video. And they also sponsored this video. So make sure you go and check them out. 4xguard.com, check it out. We have a few things to address before we actually get started with the lift. One is, why are we actually doing this lift? We're doing a lift because we want to address the tire rubbing issue that we have over here on this pinch weld and in the front as well. So hopefully this 2-inch lift will give us enough clearance so that we don't actually have any more rubbing issues here. Try to, the day before, spray a bunch of PB Blaster on any and all bolts and nuts that we'll be addressing in this video. Disconnect the battery. We're gonna get started on the left rear today. And before you go ahead and lift up the wheel, make sure you loosen your lug nuts. Make sure that you have a chock block that you can go ahead and throw under the front tire here securely. Just button that up. Also, make sure you're in park. Take our jack and jack underneath the rear axle here. Make sure we're all lined up. Looks good. Now that we have our jack stand successfully placed right here on the frame rail, we're gonna go ahead and get started on this rear wheel here. So you see we have our jack in place, and what we're gonna do is actually just jack that up a little bit right now in order to take the wheel off. All right, just enough so we can get that wheel off. Now we're gonna slowly let our jack down so we can see where that leaves the axle. Now we're just gonna leave that jack in place right underneath there. Just in case a jack stand were to fail, we're gonna leave that as a backup. And also, what I like to do is go ahead and take the wheel that we just took off and put that underneath near the jack stand. Again, just in case something were to happen, at least it falls on that instead of you. Our next step is to take off this upper shock bolt right here. Grab yourself a 15 millimeter socket and loosen that up. Next up is the lower bolt for the shock. Place that 15 millimeter socket on there. And go ahead and loosen that up.
When you're first removing this bolt here on the bottom shock mount, make sure you hit it pretty good with some PB Blaster. And then also take a wire brush to the threads on the outside here, because these threads are exposed to the elements. They're gonna rust, so you're gonna have rust in those threads. Just take this wire brush and scrape out all the rust that's in there, and it's gonna make your life a whole lot easier trying to remove this bolt.
It's on there pretty good. Remember, PB Blaster is your best friend. This shock is loose, but it's still, bolt is still in there pretty good. It's loose enough now. We could just unscrew it. There we go. And out comes the shock. Because we're removing the spring also, we'll want to disconnect the upper stabilizer link from the body rail here. You'll want an 18 millimeter socket. Now we can slowly release the jack underneath the rear axle. So you want to just push down a little bit. You only have so much room. It just takes a little bit of maneuvering, but you can eventually just pull it right out. There you go. Now is actually a good time to inspect your spring isolators. That's these little spring pads here. Just make sure they're not torn or pieces are missing. Same with the upper mount. Just give it a quick inspection. Just make sure nothing's ripped apart. And everything looks good here. So we can go ahead and install our new spring. Quick little comparison of the stock spring versus the OME on the right. See, the OME is a little bit thicker and slightly taller. It's gonna be a little bit different getting this back in here. Just note, I did cheat a little bit and I used spring compressors here to go ahead and drop that into place. But I'm gonna have to be careful here because I have a brake line and I've gotta worry about with these little pieces here for when it's time to take the compressors off. Here we go. And what we'll be able to do once this is free is we'll be able to rotate the spring so that we won't have to worry about getting access to this one. Look at that. And now everything seems like it's seated. Loosen this up. Yeah, it's still pretty tight. Again, make sure your spring pads are firmly in place, especially this top pad here. Has a tendency to drop down. Okay, so what we're going to do next is use the jack to jack up the axle and then put our stabilizer bar link back into the body rail. You want to get the bolt as close as you can get to that hole so that you don't strip it putting it back in. All right, that's pretty close, but not there. Looks like we're there. You should be able to hand start those threads and get the majority of it in there. And then you want to grab yourself a torque wrench and set that to 75 foot-pounds. Put that 18 millimeter socket back on there. And that's it for the stabilizer link. Here's a quick little comparison shot of the stock shock on the right and the one that comes with the OME kit on the left. You'll notice there's a little bar that keeps the shock compressed. We'll be taking that off before we install it. Here's our little bracket on here. So we'll want to just take that off. Just push down on the shock a little bit, wiggle that off, and now the shock can extend itself. So now it's time to install our new shock. Now the way it goes in is with the fat part at the top. So what we're gonna do is put the top bolt in, then the bottom bolt. We're gonna snug them both up, and once they're both snug, we're gonna start by torquing the top one and then the bottom bolt. So if you remember, this bottom bolt here was pretty rusty. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna hit it with a wire brush here and try to get rid of some of that rust in there. All right, now that we've got our somewhat cleaned up bolt, we can push the shock up into this mount here and get started. Make sure you don't strip the bolt as you're putting it in there. I'm gonna get it hand started. So what you can do is take a peek inside the hole over here to see how you're doing. I don't know if you could see in there, but we're a little off. But once you're able to see what's going on, you can better line that bolt so you make sure you don't get it stripped. And it's actually starting to thread now. I got it started by hand with the socket, and you can see it's coming in on this end. With the rust off there, it's a lot easier going back in than it was taking it out. All right, it's snugged, and let's snug this top one. Okay, that's snugged up. All right, so you're gonna wanna torque the upper bolt here to 70 foot-pounds. Here's the bottom bolt that we're gonna be torquing to 85 foot-pounds. All right, now that everything is bolted back together, you might wanna use this time to check out a few things while you have the wheel off. Check out your brakes, make sure there are no leaks. Check out your pads, your rotors. These rotors are actually pretty rusty, especially on the other side. So what I might do soon is actually replace them. But the brake lines look good, no leaks, and all the other bushings look good as well. So you might wanna just take this time to inspect what you have available to you. And once you're done doing that, you can go ahead and throw the wheel back on. Now, depending on how much the axle is raised, you might have to jack it up a little bit before you can get the wheel on. So let's see how we're doing here. Grab your lug nuts. Oh, might be able to get it on without raising it. Yep, looks like it. Now what we're gonna do is actually raise the axle a little bit so that we can get off of this jack stand over here. And it looks like we have it up enough to go ahead and grab that jack stand. And now you can drop. And now with the vehicle lowered, we can torque those lug nuts in a star pattern at 100 foot-pounds. Now we're gonna do this for all the wheels after we're done with each section, but just a small note here. After about 50 miles of driving, go ahead and recheck all corners by going and setting your torque wrench again to 100 foot-pounds and retorquing all the lug nuts, because some of them do become loose. So we are done with the driver's side rear. All right, so now with the new spring and shock in there, it looks like a gain of exactly 2 inches. Now the springs might set a little bit. I don't really think so. They're pretty beefy, but if they do, it probably won't be much. So right now we're at 36 inches high versus stock 34. It looks like about 34 right here. I'll just take you around real quick. This is the side that's been modified. And on the other side here, we have unmodified. So I don't know if you could tell the difference, but it actually is pretty significant. Since the right rear is the same as left rear, disassembly and assembly wise, I don't really see any point in showing you the same procedure. So we're just gonna move on to the front now.
Just a quick note, when you're working on the passenger side rear, when you extend the axle to fit the spring in, make sure you do not have tension on your brake line here or this little breather tube over here.
Before we actually raise the Jeep and take the wheel off, we're gonna want access to the upper shock mounting nuts that are underneath this coolant reservoir here. So we're gonna have to unbolt this coolant reservoir and then push that off to the side. There are two nuts on this coolant reservoir holding it to the body. And there is one down here. You can see it there, I already sprayed it with PB Blaster. And then there is another one over here, which might be difficult to see. Okay, now I have an aftermarket cold air intake, so your setup might be a little different, but I think that this nut over here is the same for everyone, because that's where this aftermarket box bolts up to. Make sure you soak this and the other one in PB Blaster before you take them off, because they look pretty rusty. So for this nut here, you're looking at a 10 millimeter. This nut over here is actually not a 10 millimeter, it's an 8 millimeter. Here we go. So yeah, you need an extra long socket there to get this nut Okay, now that actually came out as one whole unit.
Now, because we're gonna be replacing the upper A-arms, we're gonna also want access to the two nuts here on the body. And you can see, I'll come out here, zoom out a little bit so you can actually see where we are. And what we'll wanna do is remove this cold air intake and the inlet pipe here. Now your system might be set up a little bit different because I have an aftermarket Canon here, but the idea is the same. You're gonna wanna remove some intake components so that you can get easy access down to that nut. And also on the opposite side of the body, you're gonna have a nut over there, but the access to that is somewhat easier than this one here. For this part of the coolant reservoir, you'll want to get a flathead screwdriver in here to push that away from the body and off of this stud here. There is a little metal washer, very thin metal washer. Just get this metal washer separated enough from the coolant reservoir tank so that you can just thread that off. That's gonna make your life a whole lot easier just popping that off. See how easy that comes off? This point right here, you're just gonna also just get a screwdriver underneath and carefully pop that off. There you go. So that comes off there. Again, we're gonna remove some of these intake components here to give us that complete access. That can all come out as one unit. Now, while you have all your intake tubing off, make sure you grab some clean paper towels and just stuff them in right here, just so nothing gets in while you're working. In order to give yourself even more room to work with, you can disconnect this connector that's mounted here, and that'll free up the coolant reservoir container so that you can move it even further past. So it's just a grab it and pull it away from the reservoir, and then it'll pop freely. Now, we just move this literally as far out of the way as we want, as this tubing allows us. We have complete access to these four nuts. You got one back here, one here, then another one right here, which we could actually just take this, pop this right off, and it'll just wiggle free. There you go. And now you have access to that fourth one. So now what we are gonna do is hit all of these. As you can see, they're pretty rusty, with a bunch of PB Blaster, and let that soak in while we're jacking up the vehicle and taking the wheel off. What you can do after they soak a little while is just hit these studs here with a wire brush, because that's gonna make your life a lot easier when it comes to taking these nuts off so that they don't have to go by some thick threads with rust built in. And our other two nuts that we're dealing with are located down here in the front. I'm gonna spray that one. So there we have one of the connections for our upper A-arm hit with PB Blaster. And then I'm gonna take you over to the other one over here, which is kind of difficult to see, but put you in focus here. And you can see it's right there, ready sprayed a little bit with PB Blaster. So make sure you get all six of those nuts. And if you can, try to also hit them with the wire brush after you spray them. And now the last one you could hit is the top shock nut right here, right in the center there. Just soak that out. Now that we've opened up this area here, we can start to work on jacking up the car, supporting it, and then removing the wheel and starting to work on this front passenger side. Before we actually get started jacking up the vehicle, we're gonna put a chock block in place behind the rear tire. There you go. Always remember to break your lug nuts loose before you actually raise the vehicle. It's time to set your jack stand up. And we're gonna place it right under this frame rail here. Make sure not to put it in any holes. So we'll hopefully just go sideways here and it'll rest right on there. Okay, let's slowly lower that down. Okay, looks like we are supported, but what we'll do here is just jack this wheel up a little bit so that we can remove it. Now that we have our Jeep supported by a jack stand, and the jack actually raising the axle a little bit, we can go ahead and take these lug nuts off and then remove our wheel. Now, as before, I like to take the wheel and use it as backup just in case the jack stand were to fail, the car would land on the wheel instead of you. We're gonna keep the jack supporting everything for right now. because we don't want to put any pressure on brake lines or other components that we don't know are going to be pulling on the system as soon as we lower this down. Remove the brake caliper mounting bolts because the caliper has to come off. Now, you never want the brake caliper to just hang freely. So for now, we're just gonna put a bungee cord on it and then also bungee cord it to here. That way it doesn't hang free and pull on the brake line here. Just be forewarned, these caliper bolts are in there pretty good. So it's gonna take some effort to break them loose.
Got that one loose.
We're gonna wanna break the bottom one loose too.
Okay. And that one's loose.
Now that we have our rear caliper mounting bolts out with a 21 millimeter socket and supported by a bungee cord here, we can go ahead and wiggle this brake caliper off of the rotor. Once you have it free enough, make sure that whatever you're using to hold up the brake caliper is strong enough to hold it up so that you're not relying on the actual brake line for this. Bring you in for a close-up here and see what's going on. We have the brake mounted to the upper A-arm up there. It's a temporary fix for now until we find a better location for that, because we'll actually be removing that A-arm. Next up, we're going to remove the nut on the upper ball joint here with an 18 millimeter socket. Here's another part where if you have a lot of corrosion, you can hit the end of these threads that are exposed to the elements with a wire brush, so it makes it easier for that nut to slide right off. Okay, now that our brake caliper is hanging off the upper arm here, we're gonna wanna relocate this somewhere else, because that is not gonna work out when we're trying to push this through to separate that ball joint. So let's find another spot to put that. And just temporarily, I'm gonna put it right on this spring here. And then we're gonna take a little mallet and try to pop this. Everything here is under pressure, so just make sure that you have some safety goggles on before you start trying to separate this upper mount here, because this is definitely gonna fall forward as we're doing this, all right? It's gonna separate out and push this way, so just be careful. And actually, before all that happens, we might want to just take a second maybe to disconnect some of these lines here.
Just here on this arm. So they're fixed like that, and then you can literally just pop them off so you don't have to remove them. Right, so that one just comes right out, and then the same thing should happen for this one. So for this one, you got to grab a screwdriver and kind of push it back into the hole. You can see I pushed it back in there, and then you can pull it out. And that's how you separate it. So now we have this whole ABS line free, just in case this whole arm pops out as we're trying to take this and separate it.
There you go. Now that's free, and this is nice and loose, and we're just gonna leave that like that. And now, because we're gonna be replacing this upper arm here, there's no sense keeping it in there, so we're just gonna unbolt it now over here on these two spots. You have mounted here on the right, and then here on the left. Okay, so what we're gonna do here is place a 15 millimeter wrench on this end, and an 18 millimeter socket over here on this end. So we're gonna hold the 15 millimeter fixed and then use the socket to actually ratchet it off. This nut that you'll actually be removing, you can toss, because this is one of the lock nuts that we'll be replacing. I don't know if you could tell in this video, but it has an oval shape to it. So when you tighten them down, they lock in those threads. This bolt will literally just push in freely, but we're gonna leave that in place, and we're gonna go to the other side now and remove the nut and bolt, and then we'll come over to this side, do it, and we should be able to pull out that A-arm. Now again, with that 15 millimeter ratchet on the inside, we're gonna find this nut on this side, and we scraped off a little bit of the exterior rust on the bolt, and now we're gonna get this 18 millimeter socket on there. You didn't need a short socket, so you're not in the way of what looks like the AC system. Okay, with a shorter socket, throw that on there. Now we can loosen that up. Take a look and see how your 15 millimeter is doing. Hold on to that. A little tighter space to work with in here. Oh. Okay, now with both nuts off, you can take this wrench off and literally push the bolt from the engine bay out and grab it a little bit tight. What happens is the spring is in the way. So what we're gonna do is lower the axle just a little bit to see if we can get that spring to decompress. So we were able to lower that spring just enough to get that bolt out. And now we pull this arm out. So there you have the arm and the two bolts, and we're actually gonna reuse those bolts with new nuts. And there's a shot in there without the upper A-arm there. Next up is removing the lower clevis bolt at the lower control arm here. Now you'll notice on the opposite side here at the front that there is a unique kind of setup here. Make sure that this is positioned the exact same way when you're going to replace it. For this part, you'll need a 24 millimeter socket for the rear nut, and then the front bolt requires a 21 millimeter socket. Oh, it's on there pretty good. Doesn't look like you actually need a socket for the front. This is another nut that we'll be replacing because it's a lock nut.
While we're trying to relieve pressure off of this lower clevis bolt here, we're going to go ahead and remove the stabilizer bar link mount to the lower control arm right here with an 18 millimeter socket. Now this bolt that we're removing is actually a lock bolt, so we're going to replace this old one, brand new hardware. Should be careful because it's all under tension or compression. So as soon as that bolt breaks free, you're not sure if it's going to fly up or fly down. Actually what I'll do is eject this up a little bit and see if it relieves some of the pressure. So now I have the jack supporting it a little bit. I pushed up on that lower control arm a little bit. That way there was not as much pressure on this link here. This is a lock bolt. Just toss this because you're going to be using new hardware.
Next up, remove the four upper strut mounting nuts inside the engine bay with an 18 millimeter socket. Once those upper strut nuts are removed, you can slowly lower and tilt the whole strut assembly out from underneath the front fender.
I was unable to remove the lower clevis mounting bolt. It was stuck to the bushing that's in the lower control arm. So instead of going that route, I had to remove the bolt that clamps the clevis.
Before you remove the clevis pinch bolt, make sure you disconnect the ABS sensor. Here you see the clevis pinch bolt is out and the ABS sensor is disconnected from the strut housing. Now, in order to get this strut housing free from the clevis pinch bolt, you'll need to put some kind of chisel or thick flathead screwdriver to put in between the clevis pinch part so that way you can lightly tap up on the strut housing to get it out of the clevis. So here you see we have the full strut assembly, and I've placed spring compressors on it because we're going to need to compress the spring in order to reuse some of the OEM parts that are in this assembly onto our new strut assembly. After you've used your spring compressors to remove the tension on the strut assembly, you can grab yourself an 8mm and an 18mm wrench to disassemble the strut assembly. We will be reusing this upper mount. Check your upper spring pad to make sure it can be reused on the new assembly. You don't want it to be torn in any way. You'll also want to reuse the bump stop, so pull that off.
And the last part that we will be reusing on the new strut assembly is the lower spring pad. Just give it a quick once over to make sure that you can reuse it. Again, you don't want it to be torn. Remove the spring compressors from the old spring so we can use it to compress the new spring. Next up, you'll want to grab the new hardware and rotate the shaft counterclockwise so that you can allow the shock to expand. Grab your original lower spring pad and place that onto the new strut. Here's a quick little comparison shot of your original spring on the left and the new OME HD spring on the right. You'll notice that the OME is slightly thicker, slightly taller, and has one more coil. Now it's time to compress the new spring. With your compressed spring now on there, you can start installing all of the other original equipment, including the bump stop and the upper shock plate.
All right, so now what I want to do is make sure that the narrow end of this upper mount here is on the inside with this sensor mount here, because when you go to install it back into the car, you'll notice there is a narrow and wide part to that mount. Notice that we have a spring compressor on there and that it got us deep enough that 18mm nut on. Only installing this top nut 25 foot pounds. I think we're there. 25 foot pounds. Now, carefully and slowly move the tension.
Take your new strut assembly and install it into the clevis. Now just keep in mind that there is a small indentation on the lower part of the shock tube here, where it is allowing the clevis pinch bolt to slide through. So make sure you take note of that and don't put it in on an angle where you cannot get that pinch bolt to line up correctly into the threads, because it is easy to strip. So if you can't get that clevis pinch bolt to start threading by hand, then you definitely have a problem, and you may want to just rotate that tube inside the clevis until you get the bolt to hand tighten into the threads. Here's a little trick that I used on the driver's side in order to get this strut assembly back in to the clevis. Grab your clevis pinch bolt and brush off any rust that's in the threads. And if you have some available to you, throw a little bit of anti-seize on it as well.
Thing is, threads on one side, two. So the part that's actually threaded in here. Not too bad. So we install this with. Try to jack up the jack. Up your holes here. Thank you. It's all set to 90 foot-pounds. Now, in order to make our lives a little easier, we're going to put the upper A-arm in now. We got that one bolt in there. But the other bolt is a bit difficult to get in while the spring and the whole assembly is in there. So what we're going to do is lower this suspension here, jack, so that we can get that bolt to slide in the way it needs to go. So just a little bit forward is all we need here. There we go. It's in there. Push this back up. Two upper A-arm bolts. So one on this side and another on the other side. So we're going here.
Install the
lower stabilizer bolt to the lower control arm. And we're going to need to
raise the lower control arm
in order to do that. So we're just going to pump up our jack here until we get that bolt situated to the hole where it needs to go. So that actually looks pretty good. We're going to torque this lower stabilizer bolt to 85 foot-pounds. Now we have our new lower clevis nut that we can put on the lower clevis bolt that's attached to the lower control arm. We're going to torque this to 125 foot-pounds. Actually, before you get this on here, just clean those threads with a brush. We have our 24 millimeter socket on there. And we can torque this to 125 foot-pounds. Next up, install the upper control arm nuts to the body. And you're going to want to torque these down to 80 foot-pounds. Now remember, you're going to need a 15 millimeter wrench for the inside to hold that nut from spinning. We're going to install this upper ball joint into this knuckle and tighten that nut to 70 foot-pounds. And so you'll want to torque these all down to 70 foot-pounds.
And lastly, you'll want to install the caliper adapter mounting bolts to 130 foot-pounds. Then install your wheel, snug up the lug nuts, raise the vehicle with the jack, remove your jack stand, drop the vehicle back down, and then torque up your wheel lug nuts to 100 foot-pounds in a star pattern. Then reinstall everything in your engine bay, the coolant reservoir tank, and your intake tubing and airbox. Next up, we have the driver's side, which is similar to the passenger side with respect to disassembly and assembly. However, the differences are inside the engine bay when you have to remove the fuse boxes and the battery.
So these little nuts here are actually 10 millimeter. You can just unscrew them pretty simply. And to get that one, you're gonna need a wrench.
You
you'll want to stick a flathead screwdriver in here to go ahead and separate those tabs. And the third nut holding this bracket together is right here. I have additional wiring going to my ground cable, and I'll need to remove that in order to have more slack in this wiring. Disconnect this wiring from the bracket. Now you have complete access to the upper shock mounting nuts. Hit everything with a little PB blaster.
That is an 18mm socket with a half inch extension and a wrench. A ratchet neck in the end. I'm gonna angle a little bit here. Using an 18mm socket, we're going to remove this mounting bolt on the lower control arm for the stabilizer link. Only thing holding the battery in place.
There are three screws holding the battery tray into place, two on the right, one toward the front. There's also a nut down in that hole, and you'll also want to disconnect this connector here. And now we have access to one of the upper control arm nuts.
15mm on the inside here. And we're going to put an 18mm socket on the outside here. And go ahead and take that off.
Now you can remove the fender liner in order to get access to the other upper control arm nut. Here you have the entire fender liner removed.
line up with the holes right there. Make sure all four of them line up before you go ahead and start checking it up. If you notice that this bar's starting to come up because those studs are catching on the holes, just take a mallet and lightly tap against here as you're bringing it up. So each time you pop the jack, hit it with the mallet, pop the jack, hit it with the mallet type deal. Now we can start threading those nuts on. New nuts, because they're lock nuts, and tighten those to 70 foot-pounds.
Okay, now it's time to put everything back here. These are 10 millimeter nuts. Make sure nothing is getting pinched.
Next up, we're going to take our brand new stabilizer bolt. It actually is the stable bolts up to the lower control arm. It requires a new lock bolt, since that's what we have here. So what we're going to do is raise this lower control arm so that we can better line up the stabilizer link, bolt that up. You want to push the link toward the lower control arm and start the bolt so you're not starting on an angle. Now's a good time to actually start this ABS sensor back in. Flopping around, 27 millimeter, and you want to fit your cotter pin in here.
Double check to make sure your half shaft did not fall out of the front differential. Snug up your lug bolts. Remove the jack stand and lower your Jeep. Next up, torque your lug nuts to 100 foot-pounds in a star pattern. Looks like roughly 32 and a half.